Hello, I'm Bob Cannon, your Clinton Township Supervisor, and today on Care and Community, we're going to have a show like we've never had before. We have three of our top officials in each department, fire, police, and EMS Medstar, who are going to tell us some things that they're doing differently and what they're doing the same and how they expect this virus to change the way they've done business over the next probably year to 2 years, because it's different. And with us today is Kolby Miller, CEO of Medstar, John Gallagher, who is the EMF chief of the fire department, and Fred Posavetz, police chief here in Clinton Township. So, Kolby, I'm going to start with you. How has the spread of the coronavirus affected the way Medstar currently handles calls, and compare it to how you used to handle calls?
Bob, I think the biggest impact right now is the safety of our personnel when they're interacting with potential COVID patients, as well as decontaminating the ambulances so that they're safe for their next call, as well as the patient in the next call.
How do you decontaminate an ambulance?
So there's two ways that we're decontaminating the ambulances today. There is an ultraviolet light that we use for a deep decontamination. It's very time consuming and difficult to administer during the day as we move through the call volume that we deal with. And there is a liquid that we now spray in the back of the ambulance that essentially kills everything it comes in contact with in about 10 minutes. So making sure that the ambulance is clean for the crew, for the next patient, and that, you know, in between patients, we're not moving virus from one to the other. Is really the biggest change that we've seen in our system, as well as the concern from some of the patients when the crews are in gowns and goggles and masks, that they're somehow disconnected from their patient or their patient care, which really isn't true.
So this is different than what you used to do. Do you do this after every patient?
So our current practice is, and it is a little bit different than what we used to do in the frequency of the decontamination. We've always had a concern with infectious disease in patients. There have been previous infectious disease concerns, not so much from a pandemic perspective, but there's TB patients that we interact with and provide care for. There are a variety of blood virus patients that we take care of. So protecting the crews, protecting the patients, and decontaminating the ambulances is not new. The frequency and sensitivity to the decontamination is new to us now. We're decontaminating about 40 or 50 ambulances a day, where deep decontamination outside of the normal routine cleaning process before was once a week, maybe. Once every other week, there would be a patient that had enough concern that we'd have to decontaminate an ambulance. So the ambulance has to come off the road. It's out of service. The crew is out of service. The decontamination takes place. We get it back together and put it back into service. But just imagining that number of ambulances out of service at any time during the day and maintaining service levels throughout the communities that we serve, it really is a challenge.
Are you serving more people now than you were in the past? Do you see the frequency that runs up or down or about the same?
The 911 call volume is significantly reduced throughout our service area. It's down conservatively about 30%. In some parts of our service area, a little bit more. However, the critical care transports, the critical interfacility, and the air medical work that we're doing is increased right now for the same reason. A lot of very sick patients moving between facilities. We're managing the ventilators, we're managing the medications, and some of the patients are going quite a bit longer to hospitals where they can receive the appropriate care. So 911 scenes are down, critical care is up.
Okay, and the three departments for our residents work very closely together. John Gallagher, same question from the fire department standpoint. How are you doing things different than you did 2 months ago?
We're taking a lot of our guidance here in regards to this novel coronavirus from the CDC, as well as the Macomb County Medical Control Authority, and the guidance they're putting forth. And to speak to Kolby's point, this is new to us as well. We have had some policies and procedures that change sometimes daily and at times hourly in regards to our management of response as well as patient care once we arrive on the scene. PPE is nothing new to us, but the heightened awareness of this being a novel virus does speak to the fact that we're more diligent about what we're wearing, wearing the gowns, goggles, and gloves, and things that Kolby alluded to earlier. It is a stark contrast to what the community is accustomed to us looking like when we come for calls for service. We are following those best practices as produced to us through those agencies. We are as diligent as we possibly can to follow those. As everyone's aware, personal protective equipment, as you may have heard through the media, as well as other outlets, is challenging to get at these times. Everyone's in the same boat, if you will, and procuring those items can be challenging, and certainly using those in a management type of style to make sure we have those to serve everyone we come in contact with is our goal for the future.
Obviously, you work very closely with both our police department and MedStar. How has that relationship changed in the way you interact over the last 30 days?
Certainly it's changed and based on the guidance from the Macomb County Medical Control Authority in regards to the quote unquote, the lower acuity of patients or things that would more or less be a life, non-life threat to us. Per the direction, we are not responding to those runs. Master Ambulance has been picking up that run volume and handling it quite well. What we are doing on scenes is we are basically communicating actually even better than we ever have in the past in regards to making patient contact and making sure that we're all dressed appropriately and safely for the patient encounter, not only for the public that we're serving, also for us as healthcare providers.
Very good. Chief Posavetz, same question for the police department. How has this virus changed the way you conduct business?
We're learning very slowly that we have to do things differently, much like Kolby and John said about our personal protection equipment that we're now putting on our officers when they're dealing with the public. That's something that we've never ever had to do before. So there's a small learning curve for our officers to become accustomed to having that equipment on when they're talking to our citizens and interacting with our citizens. We don't have the same concerns or challenges that like MedStar has because they transport their patients, where we're only transporting when we make an arrest, and that's not that often anymore because our calls for service have gone down with the everyone staying away from each other. The only crime that really has gone up in the community, Mr. Cannon, is domestic violence. We're seeing a spike, but that's not surprising when everybody's has to be together and in closed quarters. You can almost expect people to become a little anxious after a while, and sometimes that fuels into arguments and domestic violence. So we are dealing with those kind of cases, but we're just putting on our equipment and hopefully keeping our employees safe while they're doing the job that they have to do in the community.
So the precautions have changed every time you're on the scene. If you have to arrest someone and put them in one of your vehicles, do you put a mask or a goggles or anything on the person that you've just arrested?
Their behavior is going to dictate what we do. We do have the ability to put equipment on them or something that they can't spread any disease in the vehicle, but plays right into how they respond. If they're cooperative, we don't put anything on them other than the handcuffs, which is department policy. And then once they're out of the vehicle and they're in the station after their arrest, we clean and sanitize the back compartment of the police department vehicle.
Good. Now, do you do that yourself or do you take it over to MedStar or is there a combination of the two?
Now, because of the time that we would lose, we can't afford the loss of time with the vehicles being out of service that long. So we do it, we just spray it down with a decontaminant and a sanitizer.
So I think the common theme I hear is that you have many more precautions than in the past, and you are going about your jobs differently. There's different types of runs that MedStar is making, not as many probably car accidents I would expect, Kolby, because there's not as many cars on the road. But like the chief said, there's other things that they're keeping busy with, and unfortunately, that's what we have to deal with. Now, advice for residents. Kolby?
I think the standard advice that we've heard pretty much from the start of this pandemic holds true today. Hand washing, proper hygiene, being sensitive to putting things in our mouth, touching our eyes, touching our noses with our hands, just a heightened sense of security that everything that we might be touching could contain virus droplets that would then enter our body. Social distancing certainly remains important. We're starting to see the curve change a little bit right now, certainly due to social distancing, but the heightened awareness that we don't know where the virus droplets are, we don't know how many or if they're in a room or an area that we're at, or the person that just walked past us could have been exhaling some droplets. So it really is proper hygiene, hand washing, and sensitivity to virus droplets in the air. Social distancing, masks, if people prefer them, and just being very diligent about cleanliness.
Chief Gallagher, do your fellows run into the houses the way they used to, or are they taking more precautions at the door and asking potential patients to come to the door and answer questions before they respond to whatever their needs are?
That's correct. And again, I'm prefaced with the answer from previous about the medical control ability giving us some leeway, if you will. We're actually able to make contact generally with the patient prior to arrival, have some general questions, do a little further questioning. That process actually does start with the dispatch through contact for us as well. We kind of build on the information that's received by them and try and get a clearer picture of the acuity and the immediacy of the patient that we're going to serve. Our crews are making less patient contact, if you will. We're sending in the smallest number of members that's appropriate for the run. If the acuity or the illness level of the patient dictates that the whole crew makes entry, we are certainly doing that and seeing the patient through with the care that's required for them. But also in respect of the novel virus, so we're trying to keep our exposures and down to a minimum.
Kolby, I assume that's the same for you with your dispatch?
Very much the same. So we're, you know, we coordinate the responses with the fire department, and our actions on scene are very much synchronized around making sure that the patient is getting what they need, but making sure that we're protecting the EMS crews, both fire and ambulance, so that we're able to provide care for this patient as well as the next patient, and not be taking any of this home to our families or other patients. Our mobile health paramedics are in a little bit of a different situation where they're visiting patients in the home who are critical care or high probability of return to the hospital. So the mobile health paramedics are in patients' living rooms doing general assessments outside of the 911 setting. And, you know, distancing is very difficult for them because a lot of their assessment is physical touch. So for those members of our team, we're just making sure that all of the PPE is available, readily accessible, and that they have a very quick decontamination afterwards before they see their next patient. But I think all of the public safety responders and healthcare responders right now are all sensitive to, as John said, pretty much the same things, making sure that our team is protected so that we can keep serving our patients.
Hey, Chief Posavetz, how would you advise residents to have changed their behavior over the past 6 weeks?
Well, we'd like them to get along. That would alleviate a lot of our calls for service. But that being said, we would want them to respect the distancing, the safe distancing, social distancing, as the governor's order requests, the 6 foot, not to get up too close to our officers because they're going to have to back away to maintain that distance. Obviously, when we're in certain circumstances, those aren't going to happen, and we're going to have to deal with those situations accordingly.
Okay, Chief, again, what do you think is going to stay with you and your department, and when pray that we have it soon, this COVID-19 is over? What changes do you think you will keep that have been a positive thing for the community and for your staff?
I think what everybody's learning for the first time, because we've never had anything like this before, at least in my 40 years, we haven't. And to my knowledge, it's never been this bad having a pandemic. But our officers are now realizing that there are dangers out there that you can't see. And that's something very different from what we're accustomed to. Usually the dangers that we teach our officers about are something that can visibly be seen. This is completely different to us and foreign from what all of our training has been, in that this is a deadly virus that we can't see. It doesn't give any appearance or any knowledge of where it's at. And so that's a real challenge for us. So we're going to have to go in with the assumption that that disease, or any disease, any flu-like disease, can be anywhere, and that personal hygiene and personal sanitation of your equipment and everything around you is going to be on everybody's mind from now on.
Hey, Kolby, could you answer that same question? What do you think is going to stay with MedStar and your staff after this immediate threat is over?
I think Fred's point is exactly right. The unknown virus potential of essentially asymptomatic patients. So I think that's a big change for us. Generally, patients in the past who've had infectious diseases are either aware of it and communicate it, or have outward signs that are pretty easy to see that raise our suspicion and make us think a little bit more about personal protective equipment. Now we've got a virus that many of the carriers have no symptoms at all. So from no symptoms at all to very, very sick, we're now that much more sensitive to the potential of a patient having the coronavirus, and that much more diligent in our own personal protection, as well as passing along to our healthcare partners, either our first response partners with our fire departments or the hospital partners that we deliver our patients to, when we have reasons to suspect or any indication that there was some sort of an infectious disease. I think the signs, as Chief Posavetz alluded to, the signs that we used to rely on aren't the only reliable factor anymore. And now we've just got to be very sensitive to an invisible risk.
Okay, Chief Gallagher, same question. What do you think is going to stay with the fire department long after this critical time period is over?
I think it's twofold. We certainly have to be able to adapt and overcome the situation that's presented to us. These things can happen, as we can see, very quickly over a month's time here locally for ourselves. And also, I think it hammers home that where communication is a very, very large portion of what we do, certainly with my esteemed colleagues here and also with the public itself. If we need to keep in front of these things and put out good information that's measurable, and also that serves a purpose for the community at large. If we have rumors or poor information that's out there, it takes over people's conversations, and many people believe it to be true. So I think having the knowledge of good information and sharing what we have and knowing to be accurate and keeping people up to date as to what our status would be. And certainly I think social media is a great platform for that. We can communicate to people why they may see some of the altered response patterns that we're utilizing, as well as some of the PPE things that we're wearing when we walk into the residence. And as well, also, it affords us the opportunity to communicate with the patient that we really haven't done in the past. We have information that is really pertinent to their care as to, and also notifying the hospitals. I think what's lost in the conversation to a degree is the fact that we transport these patients to facilities that have finite resources. And it does, as challenged as we are, their numbers are far greater, and the challenges there are just astronomical. And people are afraid to go for healthcare. They're afraid to leave their home if they're having a medical emergency that has no COVID relation, with a fear of actually putting themselves into the cesspool, if you will, of an emergency room. The concern could be somewhat valid, but there are also people staying at home that need to have immediate medical attention that are at times delaying it.
All of us have our staffs go home at the end of a shift. How has the mental health of your department has been affected by this very scary thing that's going on? Chief Posavetz, I'll go to you first.
Well, it's obviously a concern to all of our officers that are on the street and dealing with the public, because nobody wants to take that disease home to their families. So I'm sure that's first and foremost on their mind. What I think has helped in our environment is proactively showing them how concerned we are about their safety and doing what we can within our power to keep the facility clean, to keep their equipment clean. And I think that's gone a long way into letting them know how serious we are about keeping them safe and ultimately keeping their family safe as well.
Thank you. And Chief Gallagher, I know that the fire department has made some changes as far as how you conduct meetings. You don't bring everybody to the same location. Now you have separate meetings at the fire halls. Same question for you. How has that affected the mental health of your staff?
I think very much so. I think it's the fear of the unknown. Obviously, none of us have gone through this type of process in our lifetimes. And again, the fear of the unknown, bringing it home or the aspects might be that we're unfamiliar with. I think we're creatures of habit. We have routines that we utilize either at work or at our residence, and we don't really think twice about it. And now we need to be hypervigilant about those type of things. And behaviors are hard to change, but there's a big incentive to be mindful of these changes that need to happen. As Kolby alluded to earlier, of the asymptomatic carrier, we don't know who those folks are or who they aren't. And those folks could certainly be ourselves and bring them back home, where you have family members who may be elderly or sickly and things of those natures, put them at risk, and they see the news and they do voice those concerns when we come home. I have some colleagues that choose to live in the basements of the residents. Actually, some availability for hotel rooms are out there now for folks to not go home to try and limit the ability to bring it back to their personal residence. I think a lot of those things are very valid and very interesting ways of going about it. But the concerns are certainly there, and as we learn all together what the outcome may be, yet to be determined. I think as humans, it does raise your fear level.
Hey, Kolby, I know that there's a lot of turnover in your business because people come into your spot and they want to become a firefighter, they want to become a nurse. So you have to constantly keep changing and training people. And I saw the other day you had some cones out over behind your building and you were training some new people. Have you noticed that it's harder to attract people to the MedStar family than it was in the past?
No, I think actually right now it's kind of moving in the other direction. I think that the EMS career is a more stable career, and it's recognized as a, you know, some individuals come in and make a career out of EMS. Some come in and are working towards a goal in public safety or in another healthcare career. We offer the best offering that we can for the people who join our team. And I think this month, even if we use the start of the pandemic as an example, we've added 65 new team members to the MedStar team. So the impact of the pandemic has not affected new people joining our team. The sensitivity, as Chief Gallagher said, to the impact of any public safety or healthcare career is something that we have to be mindful of and that we have to own as agency leaders. We feel, and I feel, and probably the chiefs would agree, right now working in this and then going home to it and then seeing it on the news, it's inescapable. And where we used to play softball or go bowling or go for a run or some of the things that we all used to do to or meet up with our buddies, those things just aren't available anymore, short of going for a run. And so the escape from the stress just isn't there. And as agency leaders, we're very sensitive to making sure that we're taking care of our people. We changed our relationship with an in-house counselor that we had. And that person is available to our personnel now 24 hours a day without any path through any of our leadership team. If any of our team members feel that they need to talk to our critical incident stress team or our on-staff counselor, it's just a direct path for them to call her now and set up a time to meet with her, understanding that the stresses and the sensitivities and the concerns of our people are different than they ever have been and certainly more magnified than they ever have been. So we're making sure that that's available.
Your three organizations are very visible in the community. And I know there's been some outpouring of thanks, not only to our first responders, but also to our medical profession and the nurses and doctors that are taking care of us. Chief Posavetz, I know that some of your fellows are, your cars are going by kids' houses and waving to them on their birthday. And I know that that's been a very popular program. Have you noticed a difference in the way the public has approached and treated your officers?
To some degree, I'd have to agree with you, but truthfully, we've had an outpouring of support over the last several years. So we have a really good relationship with the citizens of Clinton Township. It has accelerated to some degree because of what's going on in the community, and they feel the need to let them know that they support us, and that's appreciated wholeheartedly from our members. But we have a great relationship, to reiterate what I just said, with our community, and we're just going to continue that. And like you mentioned, driving by some of these young people who have a birthday and they can't have their friends over, we have had a few of those requests. So we accommodate people in things that we normally wouldn't do. We're kind of doing it outside of the norm. And that's good for us, because that allows us to get out of a rut and to realize that we're still all people, and we all still need to have some sort of bonding, and we can't isolate ourselves too much. So that I think is in a good way, a way to keep connected with the community.
Very good. And Chief Gallagher, I saw the other day some of our fire trucks going down roads, just waving to people as they were going down the road. And today there's a lot, well, not today because it's snowing, but recently I've noticed a lot more people just walking in their neighborhoods, people I've never seen out walking together before. So again, is that something that you have seen a change in public relations? I know, again, same as our police department, your staff has a great reputation in Clinton Township and elsewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm serving the community is the foundation of what we do, and being there for folks in their time of need is why we're here. And engaging folks out for a walk, or even those in medical need, is our purpose. We may be the only human contact they've had in the past 2 weeks, and we have to keep sight of that. We need to come into these residences or be approachable and be knowledgeable of the current situation, and give, again, information that's factual and guidance that can be utilized not only for the folks we're speaking to, but they can share that as well as being from a reputable source, and bring some calm and some ease to those that we serve.
Very good. And Kolby, I know you're very hands-on with your staff. You barbecue for them. You do all kinds of things. Have you noticed the public treating you a little bit different with this tragedy going on?
I think we've had quite a bit of an increase in local restaurants and community agencies providing some gifts for our employees and some food before the start and end of their shifts, and we very much appreciate that in all of our service area, but particularly in Clinton Township. I think everybody is sensitive, and everybody takes a little extra time just to thank our teams across the board in public safety right now for everything that they're doing, healthcare particularly. Realizing that we're all in it as deep as we are, and have the tremendous concerns that our crews do, the sensitivity to the public because of all of the media attention to the pandemic certainly has raised the public's awareness of the level of risk that we have, and I think they're expressing a little bit more appreciation because of that. But you know, there's a little bit of a downside to that too, and we don't see it very often, but we hear it from a few of our team members, and we see it once in a while when interacting with the public, that they want to either steer clear of us or not want to be around us, or to the extent where some people have said they're not allowed to come home now because people are afraid that because of what we do every day, we're automatically carrying the virus with us. And that is kind of an unfortunate downside to this, but again, a very small component of it.
Well, the three of you have given us an insight as to the changes you've made in your departments and the changes your staff have made. One last comment from each of you as to what's going on and where you think we're going. Chief Posavetz?
Lord only knows where we're going, Mr. Cannon. We hope we're going in the right direction. We're praying that we're going in the right direction, and only time will tell exactly how this all plays out. The indicators are in a positive direction, and that's encouraging. We're taking it one day at a time. The thing that we're keeping in mind and keeping on the forefront is to keep safe when we're out there and dealing with the public, keeping the public safe, and secondly, keeping our employees safe. So that's pretty much in a nutshell, what our mission is right now.
Thank you. Chief Gallagher, same question.
Again, as the chief alluded to, where this will end is yet to be determined. We're going to continue moving forward using our due diligence and keeping our staff members as well as the public and everyone else to come in contact with as safe as possible, using best practices that established by the local agencies as well as federal. We want to see everyone be as healthy as possible. And we want to have good information that's out there. We want to be part of that process. We also want to be part of that solution. And that's our intention, is to continue to serve the public as best as we can in correlation with our partners and having a good result at the end.
Thank you. And one of your partners, a good partner, has been Medstar. Kolby, your time to summarize.
I echo what both of the chiefs say. I'm confident that we'll get through this. I think our healthcare systems are working as hard as they can to handle the current situation, keep the information coming to all the first response and EMS partners, so that we have the best information to treat patients, maintain the social distancing, maintain the hygiene practices that we're going through right now. And obviously the data is starting to turn in a favorable direction, and now is not the time to let off on any of that. And stick to what we know, get through it, take care of our patients, work together, and I'm sure we'll come out stronger.
Thank you, and I can assure the residents of Clinton Township are in good hands with our public safety. Our first responders, we are lucky to have such quality people working at the top as well as all the way down to the bottom, person who's cleaning the door handles and disinfecting your rigs. Everybody's playing a very important part, sometimes more important than we gave them credit for in the past. So thanks to your department, to yourselves, and what you do. I'm Bob Cannon for Clinton Township, CTTV. Thanks for joining us.